Okay, so again, welcome to the class. So we are going to start with list manipulation today. So we are going to start with class today. Okay. So we are going to start with list manipulation today. So we have the topics over here. What are lists? Creating and accessing lists. So we will start with this, and I'll be sharing this file with you, because already you can see there are things which are given in the form of points, and these would be like notes for you. So what are lists? Firstly, lists are collections of different elements. Fine. So lists are collection of various elements, collections of different elements, which can consist of the lists also, as well as other different types of data also. Okay, for example, you can have integer, you can have float, you can have boolean, you can have character data, and any other type of data which is there. You can have tuples within lists, you can have strings within list, you can also okay, I just forgot about that, we also have strings. So many different types of data can be there. Any type of data can be stored within lists. We can have lists of dictionaries, lists of tuples. So just write it here. Lists within lists. Then we can have lists of tuples. We can have lists of dictionaries. We can have lists of strings, and we can have lists of almost any type of element, right? So these are what? Sequences. List is a sequence data type where every element is stored and it is indexed by an ordinal number. So you can say that lists are firstly ordered collection. It is a sequence of elements. It is indexed. That is, it contains ordinal numbers. Every element is indexed. Every element is marked by an ordinal number. And also they are mutable. So far you have been working with strings, which are immutable, int, which is immutable, complex, float, which are immutable data types, but lists are mutable data types. That is, let me first explain to you how this will work. If I have a list like this, so if I have a list over here, yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I have a list over here and I want to create, I want to assign another list to it, right? So in the memory, it would be like this. That is, you will be having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you have these elements over here, and you also have a list object which actually contains pointers to these elements. So these are the pointers to each of the elements. That is the reason why list objects are mutable, and the list is like this. A label which again points to this object. So this list object would be stored in some location in the memory. Suppose I am writing the locations in this way. And we also have some other memory location where we have this one. the list which is created over here. So the list, or this is the list object, and within the list object you have different pointers which are pointing to each of these elements. Now if I want to just access any one element and assign a new value to it, I can do it easily because each of these values would be marked by ordinal numbers, that is index numbers. Okay, so if I write L2, so what should I get for L2? I should get the element 3. So if I write here L2 equals 6, that is I'm performing an assignment operation here. Okay, so L2 equals 6, so I can easily do that. What will happen, this L2, that is, this is the second element, right? So this association will be broken and this list object, this pointer would be pointing to some other memory location which contains 6, right? So this is how lists work. This is the reason, because internally lists have pointers which are pointing to different elements. That is the reason why lists are mutable. Got it? They are index, they are sequence of elements, they are an ordered collection. So now what we are going to see is how lists are created. So you can see over here, creating and accessing list. Firstly, list with no member or empty list. So how is that done? Let's go back to our Python shell. To create an empty list, first of all, you just need to write the name of the list. For example, I write L1 equals, we use a list function. Okay, so a list function is used for doing that. Its syntax will be list object equals list function. So we call the list function, or we also write, we can also write it this way. We can also create the empty list in this way, equals a pair of empty square brackets, like L2 equals pair of empty square brackets. So now if I print L1 and L2, you will see that they both are what? Empty square brackets. So now, because they are empty square brackets, it means there is no element in the list. List is completely empty. If you want to just add any element to the list, you can do it using this method. That is, I am giving the value 6 to L1. So now if I print L1, it contains one element. If I write L1 equals 7, this will altogether just create a new list. It will just replace the value 6. Okay, it will just replace the value 6, the only value which is there, because this is also considered as only as a single complete list. Whether you are providing separate values or whether you are providing values in this way, this is actually a list object. So in the memory, it would be something like this. That is, if you have a list object which is pointed by L1, this is the list object and it is pointing to the value 6. And if you just write L1 equals 7, it will mean that another list of, you are actually assigning another list to this. So this association will be broken and another list would be created, which will be pointing to 7. But if you want to add values to the same list object, then for that you will be using this expression, that is adding list elements. So to add list elements, what you can do, L1 equals L1 plus the element, right? So whatever is there, or you can also write it like this using the augment operator. So every time you want to add an element to the list, you can simply write it this way. We'll see it over here. We already have L1, which is 7, right? So we are writing L1 plus equal to 8. And now if I print L1, you can see it contains two elements, that is 7, 8. Right? Then we have L1 plus equal to 9, and you can see L1 contains 7, 8 and 9. So this way you can go on adding elements to the list. So now this is it. It's like this. That is, you are adding elements to the list. We also have an append function which we can use, which is used to add any object to the list. It could be a list object, it could be integer, float, character, string, boolean, anything. Okay, so if I write here append 10, then it will add 10 to the end of the list. We have various list functions which we will be studying in the forthcoming classes, right? So this is how if you have to just begin with the lists, you add elements to the list in this way. Fine. So one is list with no member or empty list. Next is list of integers. You can create a list of integers, like I create an list of integers, that is numbers which can contain only integers. Now lists can contain, students, please remember that, can contain identical elements, sorry, not identical, elements of the same type or different types. That is, lists can be homogeneous or heterogeneous. They can contain elements of the same type. Like here you can see the elements are of the same type, and you can also create lists which contain elements of different types. For example, marks. Sometimes marks are in integers, sometimes marks are in float. So you can also do that. So these are some examples, like integers and floating point. You can also have complex numbers over here. If you want to add a complex number, it will be of this type, 5 plus 6 j, or whatever you want to give. So you can give complex numbers, you can also add a boolean value to it, you can also add a string value to it, right? So you can add strings, characters, boolean, any type of data. In fact, you can also add lists to it, like, right? So I will just be showing it this way. Like if I write here 1, 2, 3, so you can see there is a list within a list, that is a nested list. So you can have lists within lists, any other data types within lists. So in this case, it becomes a list which is heterogeneous. Got it? That is, different types of elements are there in the lists. Next is list of, did I write it spelling wrong? Yes, it's wrong. List of characters. Now for list of characters, what can you do? Characters means single characters, right? So you can create a list of characters. Either you can do it in this way, like I'm writing ch equals a e I o I can do it in this way, or there is a very simpler way of doing it, because it, you saw it, that it takes a lot of time to create a list in this, create a list from strings. So there is a very simple method which you can apply over here. So now we have over here, that is, we have to create a list from a string. So suppose I create a string here which contains vowels. It's much easier to type strings rather than typing each character in the form of a list. So you can easily do that using this, that is, a list equals, you can use the list function and send this string object as an argument. So when you print a list, you will find that it has already created a list out of the given string. Similarly, if I just write txt equals, I write technology, or I've just written something like this, and I'm creating a list lst, and that would be list txt. And if you just print it, you will get that every character of the string has been converted into a list item, even the space. So here you can see this is a space. You cannot see it because you can only understand it by the two single quotes characters surrounding it. And we have spaces. How many spaces do we have? Three spaces. So one, two, and three spaces are over there. So you can easily create a list out of a sequence in an easy manner like this. List of mixed value types, I have already explained it to you. If you want to have something like this, student one equals I have just taken it like this. I have just written it like this. So you can see string is there, float is there, integer is there. If you need any other information, you can also add other data types over there. Or if you want to add a list of marks in all subjects, you can also do it. So I'm just randomly taking some values here, students. It might not add up to 85.5. So I have just taken some values over here. So you can see that if you want to represent marks in five subjects of any student, so that can be represented as a separate list within the list. And list of strings I have already explained to you, right? List of strings would be something like this. Yeah, actually, there is a problem of quotation marks here. So I'll be doing it on the Python shell only. So you can see that I have created a list of strings over here. There is a difference between list of characters, which is this, where every list item is a single character, and a list of strings. So here you can see these are individual strings inside the list, right? So these are the ways in which, different ways in which you can create different types of lists. Now creating list. Empty list, we have already seen how to create an empty list using the list function. That also we have seen. Creating a long list. Now, if you want to create a long list which contains a lot of values, how will you do that? So I have a list here, like I write long list, and let me continue giving some values to it. And press enter, and I'm going to just add few more values. And if I print it, you can see that a long list is created. Like if suppose you have a lot of values to be given, you can take it to some with the visible area of your Python shell, press enter, and continue the list on the next line. It will automatically consider this all the values entered as the list item. All it needs is a beginning square bracket and an ending square bracket, right? So that is how it is done. Okay. So that is it. Now, using list function, then these are long list, nested list we are going to see. So how to create a nested list? So nested list, I've already shown you an example before. You have seen it over here. That is, within this main list, you have a sublist. Okay, similarly over here also, you have a sublist inside. So usually it is like this. So this is a nested list, as you can see. So here you can see we have 1, 2, this is a list, 6, 7, this is a list item. So you can just, if you just figure out the data types, the data type of this is what? List. This is integer. Same way 4, 5 are also integers, and this is what? List, right? If you have to check the indices of these elements, how will you do it? How will you do the indexing in case of nested list? The first element you can see over here, it is a list item, so its index will be what? 0. Second item is 3, third is 4. And this way we have the elements. What is the length of the nested list? It is 4, because this is one item, 2, 3, 4, 5. Sorry, it's not 4, I wrongly said this, 5. There are 5 elements in the list, right? So 2 of the elements are lists themselves. So now the question arises, if you have a list like this, how will you access the list elements? So if I write here nested list 0, what will be printed as the answer? 1, 2 will be printed, because this is the element which is at the 0th location, that is the first location. If you want to access 2, how will you do that? Now inside the list, now in the memory, how it is represented, please look here. Nested list is an object, is a label or an identifier which points to a list object. Now there are total 5 elements, so we will be having 5 pointers within this. Now this first pointer is again pointing to a list object. You can see we have a list object here, and here it points to 1, here it points to 2. Next is 3, 4, 5, and the last one is 6 and 7, which is again a list. Right, so this is how it takes place. You can see there is nesting. There is a list object. The list object first pointer again points to another list object. That list object again has 2 pointers which point to 2 different integer objects. So these 2 are what? Integer objects. And this is a list object. Right? So this is how nested lists are represented. If again you have another list, nested list within a nested list, you will again have a third level. Here you have 2 levels, 1 and 2. You will have a, in that case, you will have a third level of a list object, which will again contain pointers to the actual elements. Right? Nested list can also be created on both homogeneous lists as well as heterogeneous lists. Right? That is those lists which contain elements of the same type also and elements of different types also. Right? For example, you want to write it this way. Student equals student 1 is equals to, I am writing the first one, which is a name, gender, total, percentage, right? And marks and subject, so I can individually write them like this. Suppose in English, he got 45. In math, he got 85. And so on, right? So this is how I'm using nested lists to represent subject and the corresponding marks. So if you want to also keep track of the subject and the marks in the subject, you can use this. Got it? So this is what, how you can create nested lists, that is lists within lists. Next is creating lists from existing sequences. So I have already told you how to create list from existing sequences. That is using your list function, and I have explained it to you. So I'm going to, because I have already told you how to do that using what? This. That is, if you have to create a list, you can also do it this way. Like, for example, a list equals list function, and you can give the string object over here, which is a sequence. If you print a list, it would be a list of individual characters. You can also write, you can also take any tuple as the argument over here. Suppose here I have taken a tuple. We know that tuples are also similar to lists, but they are immutable, right? So if I want to create a list out of a tuple, I can also do that. All you will see is that the round brackets will be removed and will be replaced by square brackets in lists. If I have a tuple over here like t1 and I give some values to it, right, and I write here l1 equals list t1, and I print it like this, so you can see that what is created, a new list is created. So it doesn't change the original tuple. The original tuple remains unchanged. T1 remains unchanged, moreover, because it is what? It is an immutable data type also. And moreover, because the function works in this way only, it doesn't make changes to the original data object, right? It creates, in fact, a new object. So L1 is a list and T1 is a tuple. Both are copies of each other. But how T1 is different? If you try to access any member, you can do that. But if you try to assign any individual item here, it is not allowed. Tuple object does not support item assignment, just like that of strings. Jaise ki string mein hota tha, it never allowed individual item assignment. Same way, tuple object also does not support individual item assignment, right? Okay. Next is accepting list from the user. Now here, this is very interesting how lists can be accepted from the user. So we will be using the input function for doing that. And we would be writing it like this. So accepting lists from user, we can write it this way. L1 equals eval input enter a list. Why we use the eval function? Because the eval function is a built-in function which automatically figures out the data type of the given data. If you are giving something like eval 3, eval 34, so eval will automatically evaluate its value to be integer. If you are giving any value like 34.5, eval function will automatically figure out that this is a floating point value. But if you are writing like this, 34 into 2. So here you can see that this 34 into 2, it is a multiplication operator, okay, my product operator. It will do the multiplication and return the value, right? And that value will be what? Integer. So eval is a very intelligent function which takes up values, which takes some arguments in the form of any data value and converts it into what? Its required data value. So here, in order to accept a list from the user, you have to use the eval function, but you will be entering the values. While entering the value, you will be entering it in this form. That is, you get this message here, enter a list. And you will be entering it in this form. right? So this way, what will happen? This eval function will be able to figure out that this is a list object which is created, and it will treat it as a list object only. If you simply give values like this, that will give you an error. So I will just show it to you on the Python shell. Like I write here, l1 equals eval. I'm first not using eval. So here if I write, enter your list object. Right, and I write here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let me print L. It prints L1, but it is not a list object. In fact, it is a string, because whatever is entered input function always considers that as a string. You have commas over here. Whatever you give over here, it will be evaluated as a string. Now, what you can do is you can write L1 equals eval L1. And now L1 will be evaluated as what? It's not a string. It is being evaluated by default as a tuple. If you want to evaluate it as a string, you cannot do that anymore. You have to use the list function to convert it. Now it is converted using the list function. So that is why I tell you, take eval in the beginning itself. Enter your list and enter the values in this way. Make sure to use a square bracket first. And now if you print L2, the values are printed in the form of individual numbers. Understood? So this is how lists are entered, lists are created. Accessing lists. This is also very important. Let me just explain this accessing list to you. Suppose you have a list here, numbers. And you have these values. Right? So each list item, similar to strings, it will also be marked by an ordinal number, that is index. So you will have both positive indices and also negative indices. Right, so you have both positive indices as well as negative indices over here. Right, so this is what lists are. List elements are numbered, and to access elements, you will make use of these indices. Like if you write numbers 3, it should return what? 40. If you write numbers minus 4, it will return 30, because this is minus 4 and this is the element that is 30, right? So the accessing technique works similar to strings. It is same as string. Accessing technique of lists is also the same as string. It means we can perform all slicing operations also, just like we had been doing on strings. If I write here numbers and 1:4, what value should it give me? 1 is what? It the first index, that is the start index. 4 is the stop index, and it is always excluded. So it will take these values 1, 2, and 3, where 4 will be excluded. So the what will be printed? The slice would be 20, 30, and 40. So this is the list slicing operation, which takes place similar to strings. It follows all the rules of list slicing in case of strings. If you write numbers 2 I had missed this that day. Yes. So right now, because it is a positive value, positive skip value. So which all values will be displayed over here? Please look at the list and tell me which all values shall be displayed. We'll start from, because there are no start index and no end index specified. So the default start index will be the first index, and the default end index is going to be the end of the string or length of the list. Okay, because we know that the end point is always excluded, hence the end is one more than the index. So we will start, it is going to access all the elements, but by a skip value of 2. So it will start from the first value, that is 10. Then it will skip it by a value of 2, that is, it will add 2 to the index 0, which will give us the index 2, right? And it will print 30. Then again, it will add 2 to this, we will get 4. So 4, that is 50. And now if you add 2 to this, we will be getting 6. We don't have 6 over here, so it will end over here. And if you similarly write minus 2, it will print everything from, that is 60, 40 and 20, right? So all list slicing operations also take place in the same way as string slicing operations. Length of a list, same just like you had in case of strings, here also you have a len function which returns the length of the string, length of the list object, right? Length of the list object will be number of list items in the list object. Number of list items in the list object, right? So this is what length of the string, length of the list. Indexing and slicing, I've already explained. It is the same as that of strings only. Then we have membership operators. Again, we have two membership operators, in and not in, to specify membership of elements in the list. Like for example, here, I'm going to take a list here, vowels, and let me create a list out of A, E, I, O, U, and also capital, or I don't need capital. I can always use the string functions to do that. I want to check whether a particular character is there in this or not. So I will simply write A in vowels. What will it give me? True. But if I write N in vowels, it will give me what? False. Why? Because N is not there present in the list vowels. Got it? And if I write I not in vowels, it will give me false. I is there in vowels, that's why it gave me false. And if I write not in vowels, it should give me true, right? So these are membership operators. They are also used in the similar way as it is used in strings. So you can check vowels. Vowels is like this. So you will have individual elements in this way. Next is concatenation, that is joining two lists. Same. It is done with the help of same. It's also the same like the string object. So if I take L1, which is 1, 2, 3, and if I take L2, which is 6, 7, and 8, and I write here L1 plus L2, it gives me a concatenated list object. Now, mark here, L1 doesn't change, L2 doesn't change. Okay, it creates, it concatenates, it returns a third list. So you can always create a third list over here, which will be a concatenation of both the lists. What happens in this case is, I'll just tell you. If I have L1, 1, 2, 3, And if I have L2, 4, 5, and 6, right? And I write here L3 equals L1 plus L2. So what is this going to give me? So L1 is 1, 2, 3, L3 is L1 plus L2. It means because L1 appears first, hence L3 will have first the elements of L1 and then followed by elements of L2. But if you write it this way, L2 plus L1, it will be just the opposite. That is 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3. So this is what? L3. That is our third list which is created. Original lists are unchanged. Please remember that. Students, the time is up. With this, I end today's class. This was just an introduction to lists, and most of the things are similar to strings only, so you will not find anything difficult in this. And moreover, it is very easy to work with lists because lists are mutable objects.